Welcome, friends. Welcome back to the kitchen. Welcome back to Sunday morning and the old cookbook show. Today we're going to do a recipe out of this 1831 cookbook called The Cook Not Mad. This cookbook is often cited as the first Canadian cookbook. It isn't. It is not the first Canadian cookbook, not by a long shot. And this myth comes about because of this 1972 reprint called The Cook Not Mad. And it blares right out on the cover that it is Canada's first cookbook. It isn't. So what you have is some publisher in the 1970s who copies directly, word for word, into this book, writes a preface and says that it's the first Canadian cookbook. But this is an American cookbook, first published in the United States. All the copies were printed in the United States, even the ones that were sold in Canada. And so what you had was a publisher in Kingston, Ontario, who saw this book and said, wow, that'd be really cool. I could sell that in Canada. So he contacts the publisher in the United States and says, can you do me a different title page, mention Canada, say that it's published in Kingston? And that's what happened. So it's printed in the United States, shipped across the border, it's got a Kingston title page on it, and it's sold in 1831. But 6 years earlier, exactly the same thing happened in Quebec in 1825, which could technically be called the first Canadian cookbook, even though, again, it is a French cookbook published in France, just with a Canadian title page. The first Canadian cookbook doesn't happen for quite a few years after this, and what I mean by that is the first Canadian cookbook written by a Canadian, featuring Canadian recipes, printed in Canada. Now, today, out of this cookbook, we're going to do something called cottage potatoe pudding or cake. And we start out with potatoes that are boiled and pared. So I've skinned them and I'm supposed to mash them. So let's get at mashing them. Now, regardless of where this cookbook was published, there are very few copies of it floating around, and most of them are in libraries or institutions. There aren't many copies in private hands. And my copy has been rebound at some point. They did a pretty good job of fixing it up, although they did put some pages out of order. So I'm sure if you study books, you'll know which one I have because the pages are out of order. So I've mashed up the potatoes. Next in, it calls for a pint of milk. And because this is an American cookbook, I'm going to assume that they use the American pint. An interesting point about this is, though, that a lot of these recipes in this book are word-for-word recipes from other cookbooks, earlier cookbooks, that I have in my collection. So whoever wrote this book just pretty much found a bunch of recipes in other cookbooks that they liked and reused them. And there's nothing illegal about that. There is no copyright on a recipe, on a list of ingredients and a method to put together a food recipe. There's copyright on a book. You can't copy the entire book, but you can copy individual recipes. And that's how recipes get shared. And so in cookbooks from this time period, you see recipes copied verbatim right down to spelling mistakes. And so since this recipe comes from a much earlier English cookbook, it almost might be safe to assume that they're calling for an English pint, that they didn't change the recipe at all to account for the difference in the size of a pint. I don't know that about 150 or 175 milliliters of milk is going to make that much of a difference. It might. This is essentially a custard. It's milk, eggs, sugar. It's a potato custard, really what it comes down to. Milk, eggs, sugar, potato, and some currants. So I'm going to continue to whip in the eggs, adding some milk and sugar as I go. Okay, last egg. Once I get this egg in, I'm going to switch from the potato masher to the spatula. I think that'll be easier to mix in the rest of it. Get rid of the potato masher. I'm going to put in the last of the sugar, the last of the milk, and I'll stir in the currants at this point. C- currents are a bit of a weird one. I see a lot of questions in the comment section here on YouTube and again on the Facebook page. People asking about currents. They've confused two different things that in English are both called currents. The currant that I'm using today, which you see in English baking recipes, is a raisin. Straight out, it's a raisin. That's the easiest way to think of it. Some places call it a Corinthian raisin. Sometimes it's called a Zante raisin or a Zante currant. They are raisins, not to be confused with the currant, which is like a black currant or red currant, which is usually served fresh and not used in baking. If it's used in baking, it would be called a fresh currant. Confusing, but English is a very confusing language because it borrows and it borrows and it borrows and then it simplifies and then it drops and then it's a crazy language. Now, it just says to bake for 3/4 of an hour. I'm going to bake it in this pan or dish. I hope it is big enough. Yep, there we go. Now, I've got the oven preheated to 350 degrees Fahrenheit because that is a safe temperature. Doesn't give me a temperature. It just says to bake 3/4 of an hour. And I have put a baking tray in there just in case this bubbles over. I don't know what's going to happen. Hey, Jules.
Hi, Glen. Hey, friends. That's really beige. Really neutral.
I think this needs a spoon. So, this is cottage potato pudding, or what else do they call it? It was undecided
pudding
what it
cake?
Was.
Pudding?
Pudding or cake. Cottage potato
really talking about that.
Pudding or cake. And I elected to put in the optional currants.
Is that a good idea or a bad idea?
I'm hoping that was a good idea.
Okay, so it's
mashed potato, milk, eggs.
It looks like mashed potato.
I mean, it's a potato custard. It's a potato custard with currants in it.
I don't know whether to try it with the currants or without the currants first.
No,
that's just bland. That's just really bland, overmashed potatoes.
No.
With a surprise of a currant.
Yeah, without currants, it wouldn't...
You might have done better with carrots and parsnips or something.
Well, it's not too different from a mashed potato pie that we made. Probably six or 8 months ago we did that.
I can't remember if that was good or not, though.
I don't remember either.
No, I can't remember if we liked it.
But there's a whole group of custards where you put root vegetables in it. I mean, sweet potato pie is essentially a custard with sweet potatoes, but the sweet potatoes bring a bit more flavor than just regular mashed potatoes bring to the party. Carrots, we've done a carrot pie, which was essentially a carrot custard in a pie shell.
That was pretty good, though.
That was pretty good. You could do it with parsnips. This is not...
That's not for me.
No. But in the context of 1831, living in the frontier where a potato was something that was very easy to grow and stored really well, this could have been a treat.
And maybe you put caramel sauce on it or something. I don't know. But then that's butter and sugar you may not have. I don't know. I can't even think of ways to help this.
You might have put jam on top, or there might have been another sauce that you would have put with it. But no.
I don't know. Like, and then maybe you weren't supposed to eat it as... Well, they call it a pudding, though, and
it's
a cake,
pudding.
Which suggests after supper versus, you know... Yeah, no.
Not a winner. No. 2021. I don't know that there's any way to even save it.
No.
Thanks for stopping by. See you again soon.